Very good morning to everyone, and thank you for joining in. My name is Krishna, and I'm a director here at Tsaaro. I look after security and privacy compliances. The topic for today's webinar is consent management requirement for banks, an overview, and a little bit about Tsaaro. If you are new to our webinars, or if you are someone who's not attended one of our previous webinars, we are a data protection consulting firm. And people who do not know about Tsaaro may have been associated with Tsaaro Academy, which is our data privacy training academy. And we are a consulting firm focusing on the niche data privacy. We help in compliances, we help in implementation of program frameworks, and that is how we also conduct a lot of webinars around data privacy as well as security awareness or data protection awareness. Now, looking at your speakers for today, I'm Krishna, of course, on the left side of this screen. We also have Tanin.
Hi, everyone. Hi, Krishna. This side, Tanin.
Tanin is a fellow, you know, in data privacy. He understands a lot around the data privacy nuances in the financial services industry as well. So, Tanin, I would just hand it over to you if you can introduce yourself to all our attendees and the kind of background that you have.
Sure. Well, I have around 15 plus years of experience, and I have been working with the financial company from past 8-9 years, and I'm a CIPM certified data privacy and EU GDPR practitioner from TUV, and also I am ISO 27001 certified. Apart from that, I have done a couple of certifications previously, but let's not discuss on that, because these other certifications will help you to understand what exactly my role into privacy and how I am working. So right now, the current role, I am leading the data privacy and protection manager for the financial company. It's a startup, more of a startup and a company that I can talk about, which is around a couple of years in this organization in India and across the world. And I head the whole data privacy and protection manager team.
Yep. Thank you, Tanin. Thank you for that introduction. And about me, I have been dealing with security and privacy compliances for the most part of my career. Started with audits, and that's how I got into security as well. Started with network audits, something which is seemingly more complicated than it looks like. And that is how I got into security and probably experimented with a few different service lines and, you know, kind of got hooked on into security and data privacy now, right? So that's a bit about me. And just a disclaimer from both of our ends that whatever we are discussing today, or whatever knowledge is being shared, or, you know, whatever is being discussed with the attendees, is something that is purely educational, right? It's not something that is also representing our organizations or where we come from. And it should not be taken as legal advice either. Right. So this is purely based on our understanding or our knowledge around the consent management requirement. And if there are any questions towards it, towards the end, we have a Q&A which is scheduled for all the attendees. But at the same time, the chat section is open. So you can probably just pose your question there if it's relevant to the current topic that is being discussed. And Tanin and I would be more than happy to take it up from our end. Right. So a bit of the agenda for today, right? What are we about to discuss? We'll start with simple definition of consent management. What is consent management? How does it matter to different organizations? And how does it specifically matter to banks or NBFCs or all financial organizations in India? The kind of laws and regulations in India as well as EU. The reason we usually put EU here is because, you know, of GDPR, which is sort of taken as the benchmark for all kind of data privacy identifications or regulations that would be applicable to any other country too, and the kind of impact this consent management principle would have on the banking sector, right? So this is the kind of storyline we have defined for today and the flow of today's webinar. And if you have any questions, of course, feel free to, you know, also come up with them. And one more thing that we usually conduct all webinars on Menti, right? So Mentimeter is something we actively follow to also understand whether our attendees are also understanding the different nuances that are being discussed, right? So Himangi has put up a link on the chat section. You can quickly click on that link and share your responses here. The question is that How frequently do you provide your personal information to complete a bank transaction? Right, a bank transaction could also mean a UPI transaction or a direct bank-to-bank transaction, as the old days. Now, because of the UPI infrastructure, things are really, really easy. And if you have been following the news, you might have also heard about the digital rupee coming in. Right. So the question again to all the attendees, how frequently do you provide your personal information to complete a bank transaction? Right. I'm waiting for some responses. We have often, we have minimal. That's, two different ends of the spectrum too. Right. Waiting for a few more responses, people, if you can quickly click on that link, or you can also go to menti.com and complete that.
So we have a response on the chat itself. Someone has said minimal times.
Okay. So I think what we see, Tanin, here is that, different responses from both ends of the spectrum, to from minimal to often, right? And not at all is also something that people have shared. So that's something that's good to see, because we will probably try and cover how it actually matters from a concern management perspective. Right. So I'll hand it over to you, Tanin, if you can also explain what is consent management from a financial services perspective, and also the features of a consent management lifecycle that we would like to discuss. So I'll just hand it over to you now.
Sure. Thanks. Let's start with the consent management to understand what exactly is consent and what exactly the management is all about. But before I start, let me tell you, the chat is open. Please, when I am asking any questions, so just put a response over that. So it will be more of an interaction, so that we understand what amount of information that you could have gathered from this presentation, and where we can be more helpful for you. Okay, let's understand what exactly is a consent. Consent is what? Agree to something. So if we agree to something, that's where the consent is all about it. Now let's understand the consent management out of it, from the word consent. So consent pertains to the collection of an individual's personal data, which is then processed for purpose such as marketing, analyzing, or customer service. So this is exactly the definitions of consent management. Consent is getting agreed to something, and where we are, there's a management out of it to store this, process our consent somewhere at any point is what the consent management is all about it. Now, nowadays, consent management is either being taken by some tools, third parties, or so many other applications where the banking systems are helping to achieve the consent from the customer, which is very much important. As either you talk about GDPR, you talk about any privacy laws, consent is something very important to nowadays. Now, what are the positive point of having a consent? Positive points of having a consent, then banks can build, innovative tools and feature that meets customer needs. That are the positive point of it. But if you think of a negative word, yes, we got to know the negative part of it, because of the fact that what the bank can also, over-process your personal data. So we got to be very sure that what kind of consent we are giving across and how much consent we are giving across, and banks should always process to the consent that has been provided across to the customer or to the data processing unit, which can be a bank. Any question from your side, do let me know to understand the consent and the consent management and how this is the features. And I'm specifically talking about the banking financial sector, because of the fact that the presentation is all about a banking domain. Okay, let's move to the next.
So Tanin, I just wanted to add on to that as well, because I think most of the people here, the attendees might have also read the draft Personal Digital Data Act that came up recently, right? And as per that act, there is a requirement, or there's a mention of consent manager. True. Right. So what is your opinion around it? What do you think, why do you think a consent manager would be relevant in today's times?
Right.
Even from a banking or a general perspective.
Right. If you have gone through the DPDP 2022, which got launched, the draft bill, which got launched in 18th November, you'd see that government has mentioned consent 37 times. So you can understand the value of consent has been given across in the privacy bill. That is the second most used word in the DPDP bills. Now, yes, in banking financials, consent management is very important. Either you take it, either you keep it in the third party vendors, or you keep it within yourself. But the DPDP bills is talking about that we will have a consent management platform where you can save your consent, and the banking can process, the customer can give their consent to process their personal data out of it. Do I make sense?
Yeah, definitely. I think we also have a couple of questions from Anil on the chat section. What is a DPO's role into consent management? And then what is consent? Is it a rule or is it an article?
So the consent management in DPO is important because of the fact that the DPO is part of your banking system. So banking system, the DPO needs to make sure that there is a consent management that's put in place. So they are taking the consent from the client or the customer while processing the personal data of the individual. So that's where the DPO role comes into picture, because if anything goes wrong, the first person come into picture is the DPO. So the DPO's roles and responsibility to make sure that the consent management has been followed across is one of their key responsibility of DPO.
Right. And I think the second part of the question is around what is consent? Is it a rule? Is it an article? Is it something that's, you know, strictly mandated by the law, or how is it defined from a law angle too? From a legal perspective, how is it defined?
So either you pick up GDPR or you pick up DPDP. Consent has been a very important, played a very important part. Whether it's a consent is a kind of, I would say, a rule. There is no article out of it, but there's a rule kind of thing where you got to have it. It's laid out that the consent management is very important while you do data privacy in any organization.
Perfect. I think this is around, you know, what is consent management. We discussed about the definition, the features, the positive, negatives. Also around, you know, how is consent management perceived as a rule or as an article, and how can a DPO also put in their role when they have to manage consent management, right? So I believe we have answered your question as well, Anil. And if you have any follow-up questions, you know, you can just direct them to us again. Now, let's go back to Menti a little, right? Before we talk about the consent management lifecycle, I would want to understand if our participants understand that how the consent management lifecycle occurs, or what are the key steps in a consent management lifecycle. So, you know, there's a link in your chat section again. My teammate Himangi has put it up there. So if you can click on that link. And what do you think, what is the next step in consent management lifecycle after collection of consent? Right. So the first step would be collection of consent, after which you determine whether you need to process that personal data or not, or any kind of data associated with the individual. And then what do you think would be the second step? Would it be process the consent, destruction, or storage? Okay. We see that some people are going for storage, some people are going for process. Okay, perfect. So I think we have a fairly mixed response here. And I think it's time for also me to push everyone to the next slide where we talk about a consent management lifecycle. So Tanin, over to you again. Let's go about the five different steps of a consent management lifecycle and also discuss the answer of the previous question we have put up.
Yes, the answer to the previous question is all the three steps are important because of the fact that we have to take the consent, store the consent, and also process and do revoke also, do delete also, wherever there is a request from data subject to delete that. So I would say that let's get to understand this by an example. Probably that will make things very clear. Now you go to a bank and then you give your details to process your salary account. So what you do, you put all your details and then say that, you know, I agree to the fact that you let me send the details of message me when there is a credit or debit in my account. So what are you doing it? You're doing giving a consent to process and also notify you when there is a deduction of or addition of amount in your account. So that's where you're giving a consent. Now what they're doing, now the bank has picked up, bank has stored that consent. So collection has been done at the first stage. Second step, they have stored the consent. Third, they have processed the consent to make sure on the first of every month when there is a salary has been credited, you get a message in your bank account or your mobile. That's where they are processed. The process of the consent has been happened and you are getting a message out of it. So this is where the process of the consent happened. Now revocation. Now after a few days, you feel that, you know, I don't want it. I don't want the message to come to my on my mobile. So you go ahead and ask for that. I revoke the messaging facility to my account. Other than that, rest all consent as okay. You can process my PAN card. You can process my other details and other thing, but do not message me. That's why the revocation happened for the specific consent that you have asked for. The third is after your engagement with that bank is over. For example, your engagement with the bank is over after 5 years, 3 years down the lane, and then you ask for the bank to delete everything. That's where the destruction of the consent is happening. So I hope not by going more details, by an example, you would have understand what exactly each of the steps of consent management lifecycle is all about it.
Right. So Tanin, what happens if the organization does not respond to your revocation of consent request, right? As an example, because I'm talking about a personal experience, right? I was a customer of one of the, you know, NBFCs, and it's a B2C credit line. So I was a customer of them, and they kept messaging me on WhatsApp around the updates and around their product or the updates around the new services that they have in line. But they also gave me the option to stop receiving those messages. Mm-hmm. Right. So I clicked on the stop on WhatsApp, but seemingly it does not work. And I still receive those messages probably twice every week. So is there a process as a customer? What can I do? Or as a user, what can I do to make sure that the organization is held accountable, or I can put up a request to, you know, stop them from sending out those messages to me?
Yeah. So let me answer this question based on India and based on outside India. So in India, yes, right now, yes, we do not have. Until unless the DPDP law come into picture. But if in case you are in outside India and you are following any GDPR or any kind of data privacy law, there you have the rights. So data subject rights is there. So you can challenge them saying that you can put a complaint. You can put a complaint saying that that you have asked for something which has not been done. Then yes, the revocation of your consent should be processed, and if not processed, then you can file a case because of the fact that it's a data subject rights outside India. But even when DPDP laws come into picture, yes, you would also have this some kind of clear idea of what kind of consent viewed as a data subject or data principle, whatever we call it as an Indian DPDP laws, we have it. And thereon, we can put a request to your bank. And if you go to any privacy policy of any bank, I mean, if you open up any website of the bank, you would see the privacy policy. There you would see the point of contact, the escalation, the grievance email address, and the compliance email address that you will find there. You have the right to question back them. You have the right to email them and ask that, you know, something I have asked for. My consent has been asked for to remove the access or to remove the consent of sending me SMS, WhatsApp, whatever. But it's not been done. But yes, you do have the right to do that.
Perfect. I think that answers my question as well. In India, we don't have a law specifically yet. We have a draft act that is there, but it's been around for a while. The different one as well, the 2018 one. And based on that, I mean, because RBI is also trying to come up with certain privacy-oriented guidelines or requirements. But then again, because we do not have a holistic law that can take care of all the data privacy-oriented questions, which is why it is also not possible or easy or relevant for the NBFCs or financial organizations to comply with those guidelines. Because I was in discussion with one of my clients who is in the similar sector, and they had a question around one of the newer RBI guidelines. But when we had a discussion, we also understood that they are still in touch with RBI to understand how exactly to also implement it. Right. So having said that, it's very easy to write a policy or a law, but to actually implement it in the back end is where the real challenge lies. Right. As an example, if you look at the consent management lifecycle, if the user is given the right to revoke consent or to revoke or object to any kind of automated processing or any kind of processing of personal data, How does the organization actually identify the different kind of personal data in different systems within its IT infrastructure? Right. So that's the difficult part from an organization's view on how to identify and delete that data. But from a user's perspective, they simply have to just, you know, put up a request to the organization. Right. So these concerns on how to actually implement it is also something you will have to read upon more about, or, you know, have a discussion with around with other data privacy professionals too, on what kind of, for example, data discovery tools they would need, what kind of processes they would have to create to also respond, or also to be able to respond to these consent requirements. Now, Tanin, as per your opinion or as per the slides as well, why do you think consent management matter in terms of the GDPR or any data privacy law?
Sure. Just before that we start, I'll just keep put a note. Probably this is very interesting and people would love to hear that. The consent is there, consent management is there, but you cannot say that, please delete all the details, or please do not process my PAN card. This is not possible, because as per the law, your PAN card is required to process the IT, the income tax and other details. So with respect to India, you cannot go ahead and say that, you know, do not process my PAN card details and do not do that. So even if you have the rights of giving a consent management to it, but the fact that you also need to understand that you just cannot ask for, or you cannot just cannot ask for anything that you, under consent management. Probably that is one of the note that we would like to understand. That's where the consent management is all about it. Okay, so exactly, consent management do matters a lot, because with respect to GDPR and all, consumer demand and data and privacy transparency, it clears out very black and white to what exactly we are. It's a kind of a clear indication between, or clear table between the data subject and the data processor, where we are making sure that what we will process, and it keeps transparency while processing your personal data. So it's very important. And then obviously then putting up the next point is non-compliance can result in legal issues. I mean, if you are outside India and GDPR is one of the privacy laws, then non-compliance can result in legal issues. But that's what Krishna was talking about, what he faced in India. But if he would have faced in outside India, he could have put a legal case against that company. And it builds trust. So no doubt about that. When you have a trust between your data subject and the data processor, you achieve more customer, you achieve more business. So for example, if I get a very good service from one of the banks, I would refer to another colleague of mine saying that, you know, this bank is doing such a good work. The bank is following my every steps that I ask for, the consent that has been asked for. Or every time they ask for me whether should I process it, when I give a consent, then only they do it. And when I can revoke it, then they do follow the process. Now this becomes very, it builds trust. And then this trust, you got to, when you reciprocate the same trust, and then say that to your colleagues and others, probably the business will increase. They would have a trust on that bank, and the bank will get more customers. So that's where it builds trust. Now, so moving to the next is, organization should use strong identity verification, which means that whenever you have putting a consent against your personal data, or the way the data will be processed to the data processor, so it becomes a verifications kind of a thing, where you are verifying the information that are being processed or being supplied to the data processor. So that brings into the identity verification of the personal of the data subject, and obviously withdrawal of consent. So yes, the withdrawal of consent should be easy. What Krishna was defining that with one of this issue when he couldn't get his consent revoked. But yes, consent revoke is very important. It's not just revoke, and also deletion is a very important part of it.
Right. So just wanted to add on to Tanin's point as well, right? The second point, when we talk about how non-compliance can come with legal trouble and fines, it's not only about legal troubles and fines, it's also about the reputational damage, which is irreparable, Right. So I was just looking at a LinkedIn post from one of a fellow colleague in the data privacy domain, and they had a post around the Swedish financial service giant, which had a valuation of around 64 billion, if I'm not wrong. And because of a fine for privacy, their valuation has gone down to around 4 now. Right. So that kind of change happened because the market lost trust, or even investors these days are actually looking for products or services that has a kind of trust built around the organization too, right? So there needs to be some kind of compliances that you have to strictly follow. You have to strictly generate that trust with your customers, with your vendors, with your investors as well, right? So that is what the trust part talks about. And Tanin rightly mentioned that building up that public trust is very, very crucial to products these days, because we are moving to a trust environment. And most of the privacy management platforms are also building up that community now. Right, because of the cognizance of how products should be built these days, these factors are actually coming into role. Even if you look at it, from a business angle, these are really, really crucial points that all of the people around are considering before purchasing a product or a service. The last part, withdrawal of consent should be as easy as consent collection. If you look at cookie banners these days, and if you are providing, some kind of consent, maybe accept, decline to the cookies on a website, then you would see that most websites do not really have an option for you to also revoke your access or change the kind of consent you have provided to them. Right. So that is something that is directly against the law. It's directly against the e-privacy directive as well as GDPR. Right. And consent should be as easy to withdraw as it was easy to collect, right? So this particular feature where the cookie banner is not available after you click on either accept or decline is one of the non-compliances when we do a cookie compliance audit as well. So it's something that you also might want to take into consideration when you're looking at consent for websites for any organization, right? So how to go about consent management? What are the implementation steps? And as an organization, what are the processes you may want to develop to also align yourself to a consent management lifecycle? So Tanin, again, I'll hand it over to you if you can explain everyone around the four key steps we have identified here, and talk a bit about that too.
Well, who all in this panel do understand deeming cycle? Just reply on the chat, yes or no. Deeming, D-E-M-I-N-G, deeming cycle.
Right, everyone, it's a simple yes no question. You can put it in the chat section. Do you want me to spell it up, Tanin?
Yes, I am putting it on the chat.
Yeah,
I'll let you know what exactly it is. So deeming cycle is nothing like it's called. There's a four steps to it. It's plan, do, check, act. Now if you have followed this 1, 2, 3, 4 steps, it's nothing but the same thing. Every organization, when they want to implement something, this is it's a basic. Is a basic where it comes into picture. And this is nothing, but let's not make privacy very tough to understand what exactly it's all about it, but understand the fact that what exactly the crux behind it. It is deeming cycle, plan, do, check, act, how. Let's understand one by one. Analyze is something like a plan. You plan it, you analyze whether you need it. You understand the need of the consent management, whether your company do process personal information, do your company need and consent from a data subject. So that's where you analyze, that's where you plan it. Next step, design it. Now, what you've got to design, to make sure that the consent management is in process. You got to make sure that either there's a modify the current, if you have a current process, you've got to modify them. If you do not, you have to define a new one. That's where you plan, that's what you're part of the design phase. The next is implement phase. Now that's where the check phase happens. Implement or check, what we call as a deeming cycle. Where you do that, either you do it by yourself or banks, or give it to a third party or tool under the consent management system, where they take the consent of the individual, where they manage it, if there is a requirement of deletion. So all that is part of the implement. Now act, now maintaining part of it, maintaining, keeping an option to edit, regulatory and compliance development. This is all part of the operational. Now this is what exactly the plan, do, check, act part of Deming cycle is what about the slide is talking about. I hope I was able to make sure and make you understand what exactly this the consent management go about.
Right, so it's also very similar to the PDCA cycle, you know, in ISO 27001, or if you have implemented any sort of security or privacy frameworks or audit frameworks as well. So when even you conduct your audit, Plan, Do, Check, Act is something that you widely follow. And even when you implement a new project or a program, this is something that you follow, right? So PDCA or Deming cycle, different terminologies, but effectively it kind of relates to the same implementation process that we are trying to cover. So any follow-up questions on this, any particular section you would want us to deep dive on? So we are happy to cover that. Maybe, you know, talk a bit about the design part, because that is where most privacy questions come up, right? Whenever we talk about privacy by design, it's a fairly interesting topic where a lot of subjective discussions, debates happen on why does one person feel that this design is better than the other. And something that I've also been following these days is, if you've played Candy Crush Saga, right, one of the very popular games these days. And so Candy Crush Saga, their parent company Kings, they came out with a new kind of privacy policy, a very interactive privacy policy, something which is, you know, very, very interactive with the individual and also tries and helps them understand how privacy should be framed or how do they take care of the personal data they collect. But even around that particular interactive session, there was a lot of discussion or debate around whether the design was pushing people into the dark patterns known into secure privacy, or if people were also looking at you know, certain guidelines that are not related directly to GDPR either. So we'll also take up Anil's question, Tanin. Is it the company or the bank consent management process? Anil, could you please rephrase your question? Because I believe there are a few keywords that are probably missing here. Is your question that whether it's the bank or the company who has to implement a consent management process through a tool? Okay, so I think, Tanin, the question is that whether consent management has to be done through a tool or has it to be done manually, right? What would you recommend, and in what cases, what would be the better approach to do it to?
So Anil, to answer your questions, again, with respect to GDPR, with respect to DPDP 2022, the draft bill. Now, to answer your with respect to DPDP 2022, we have a slide later in this presentation where we can talk about more how exactly the DPDP 2022 talks about the consent management and all about it. Now, if you're asking about the company and if this question is based off the privacy laws of GDPR or something like that, yes, GDPR talks about whether the information is either taken manually or by tool. The more you take manually, the more you would be facing in issues like, you know, how do you manage it? Now, either you take it manually or you take it electronic or automated process, but you got to take it for GDPR. And GDPR talks about that consent management is very important, and either you take it manually, but understand the fact that if I take it manually, it would be my, as a data processor, it would be my a tough process for me to understand what exactly the data subject has given a consent about it. But having it an automation process on some kind of tool, application, website, wherever the data subject can give their consent, it makes me easy to process it and also to take regular consent of it. For example, I cannot take a consent for a year's all. For example, I take a consent for some processing of personal data, and I cannot take for the granted that this consent is for the lifelong, where this consent is only for some period of time. And I would mention that the consent is for 1 year, 6 months or something down the lane in the written document. And once again, I'll take the same consent after that specific period of time. So understand that the fact that if I keep this as a manual, how tough it would be to manage it in future.
Right. I think that's a fairly good point as well, Tanin, because I would want to go back to the previous slide, right, looking at the life cycle. So if you look at this life cycle, if you try and do it manually, it won't be very easy for you to manage this life cycle. So a tool is preferred, A tool can be created as well if you have a fleet of developers who can help you create a tool, or you know, it's not a very complicated tool for a smaller organization. But if you're a global organization with presence in multiple countries, different kind of compliances to data privacy laws as well, right? Then in that case, it would not be something that you would want to manage manually, right? A tool is preferred there. So having said that, we'll go on to the next one, right? We'll also try and understand if our users have some kind of understanding of consent that we have discussed so far in this webinar. Right. So again, the link is here on the chat section. My colleague Mukul has put it up. Please use this link to answer. What is your opinion around consent? Consent should be the free, prior, informed, or all of the above. Right. So just a, okay, perfect. We have our first few responses coming in. Okay, that's a mixed response now. Then earlier, I think people were more oriented towards all of the above. Now, informed, prior, and free are also something that's in people's mind. Happy to see that. Happy to see that subjectiveness, because that's what privacy is also about. Right. So I believe majority of you folks have decided that consent should be all of the above. It should be free. It should be informed, and at the same time should be prior. Yeah, Satish, I believe you have a question. If you can put it in the chat section, please. For the survey questions, privacy note required. Oh, do you mean we need to put out a privacy notice for this survey, for the, these questions that we are putting up?
The question is actually the same, what you said. See, now you provided the link for actually to answer this one, right? So just for understanding, I'm asking. This, actually, do you need to provide some privacy note to the people or actually something like that?
No, because Satish, first and foremost, India does not have
asking, generally asking, this is a survey kind
fine,
of thing, right?
Of course, of course. See, I think we have discussed this earlier because India does not have a Personal Data Protection Act as of now, right? So by law, we are not required to notify. The second part is that Mentee collects your responses, and we do not see who is sharing what kind of response. So it's kind of anonymous to us. We just look at the number and the kind of data around what options you are choosing, right? So we have no visibility on who is selecting which option.
Yeah, but in this scenario, if you are capturing my name, for an example, okay, I'm talking about for example, okay, if in case if you are capturing my name for this response, do we require actually consent, means actually a notice to be placed?
Yeah, so if you are in the EU region, then menti.com would work differently. When they collect that response from you, they should ideally notify you that this is what we will do with when you are using the application or when you're using the software. This is what the organization intends to do. So that kind of notice needs to be there, because the tagging that is there is also being handled by a different company, not by us, right? So Mentee would be the one who would be putting up that notice or taking your consent if it is required.
Agree. Thank you.
Perfect. Okay, so Tanin, I'll hand it over to you again. How should banks implement consent management practices, withdrawal collection, purpose limitation, communication? So let's just touch base upon the different requirements around implementation of consent management practices. So over to you, Tanin, again.
Sure. So the four steps of what you mentioned are withdrawal, collection, purpose limitation, and communication. And if people have gone through the principles of GDPR, it's all about all that has been mentioned and very crisp way. Now, why do I say that? Withdrawal, EU GDPR Article 7, I mean, that talks about banks must not ensure security, but gives consumers the opportunity to change their minds and revoke the consent. So, which means that the bank has giving a facility to the data subject to make sure that they can withdraw their consent and also change their minds of, for example, if they want to have a selective consent for few of the facilities and not for all, that is for perfectly okay for the data subject and that data processor part of the withdrawal. Now, collection. Now, we got to obtain periodically. That is what I was mentioning a few slides back, that you cannot think to the fact that, you know, I have got the consent and I can keep it for the lifelong. So you got to critically review the consent. You got to critically ask the data subject to make sure that they provide the consent for next 3 years, something like that, or something like next 5 years. So you got to mention that how for how long this consent will be valid. And obviously the withdrawal is there, then withdrawal and any modification is there on the consent, that's perfectly fine. But you got to mention that, you know, this consent that you are giving is for 5 years or probably 3 years, and post that we'll come back once again to take your consent once again. So this is one of the collection and the collection. Now, purpose limitations. Now, I am taking the consent to do some to give some facility to the data subject. Now, what happens in India, and let me take this example, that we give our banking details. Now, banking details then process to a third party who then calls us for any kind of loans, credit card, and all. That should not be part of it. And if you're going to GDPR or privacy laws across other countries, they stop, they don't allow such kind of process of data for other reason. That is, for example, if I'm opening an account, bank account to process my salary, to get my salary, that's all, it should be part of it. So the limitation of purpose should be part of it. Now, communication. So being transparent to customer is very important. Now, why the data has been taken and what we will do with the data from the data subject. So if you talk about this point, the communication, it's related to the same thing, one of the principles of GDPR, which is lawfulness, fairness, and transparency. So if you understand the one of the principles of data privacy, GDPR, which is lawfulness, fairness, and transparency, which relates to the same thing, to the communication that's part of the document that you can see on the screen.
Right. So adding on to that point, and in the last point about communication, there's been a lot of deliberation around how should a privacy policy or a privacy notice be framed. Right. So the answers also come up from what supervisory authorities suggest in this case, that ideally the language of a data privacy notice or a privacy policy should be something that a 12 to 13 year old could understand. Right. And there are free websites on the internet that can help you identify that the wordings or the language you've used for a privacy notice or a policy, is it something that a 12, 13 year old would be able to understand, or are the keywords that you're using are too technical or too complicated for someone, you know, with that demographic age to understand, right? So when you are framing your notices, your policies, make sure it does not include a lot of technical jargons, and instead look for the kind of communications recitals that supervisory authorities have come up with, and try and follow that, because it also relates to how GDPR should be actually perceived and what kind of communications have been coming up from supervisory authority based on some previous cases too. Right. So these factors may help you actually create the right set of communication channel as well as notices and policies. Right. So any follow-up question on any of these section here? Perfect. Right. So I think, Tanin, this is also something that we wanted to discuss, right? Anil had a question around how it compares to the Digital Personal Data Act. Apologies for the typo that I see here on protection, but Tanin, could you also focus a bit about here and what would be the consent manager here in this case too?
Now, well, from this slide, probably we need to understand then data processor, what we have discussed previous slide, is the same as data fiduciary. And data principal is what we mentioned out here, is the same as data subject in the previous slide. So the naming has been changed for India. And the fact that you got to understand that what exactly the data processor is nothing same as a data fiduciary, and a data principal is same as a data subject, what we understand. Now, this is a bill that has been, I hope many would have aware of the bill that has come across, the draft bill, if I can talk about, that's 18th November 2022. Now, if you read the bill, I have already mentioned previously in the first slide itself that consent management is very much important that has been given into this bill. Now the consent of the processing of the personal data should always be tracked. So that needs to be part of it. So the consent management or consent part of data privacy, data DPDP, which has been explained via something called as a consent management platform. Now, what exactly it is? It is kind of a bridge between a data principal and data fiduciary, which I mean by data subject and data processor. It's something kind of bridge who would be taking the consent for you, who would be managing the consent for you, and who would be accepting the consent, manage the consent, review the consent, and help you to withdraw it. So it's kind of a platform that would be there. in between the data subject and the data processor who would help you to do that. Now, this consent manager that we are referring in this slide should be registered with the board. The board, the government would be describing a board out of data privacy for India, and for that board, they would be registered under that board. So, can be companies, can be third party companies, can be third party applications who can be getting registered, which we are thinking that will get registered under this board, who can provide this kind of consent management for the data subject and also for the data processor. So every time the data subject did not need to, data processor did not need to reach out to the data subject, probably this third, the bridge in between would take care of all that.
Right, so this new topic that the consent manager needs to be there, or is something that would, you know, also help comply to the requirements of the bill or the act, is a newer concept, right? Looking at that, the consent manager also needs to be registered with the board, right? The data protection board that will be created by the government entities. Now, looking at that, you know, it's a fairly new concept on how these management platforms should be built within India. And also, having said that, how is it also aligned to the individual or unique processes or culture processes within India too? Right. So these are some of the key aspects that you might want to look into when you're also reading about the consent manager on the bill's perspective. Right. Looking at deemed consent, right? It's the most debated or one of the most debated topics within the act. So Tanin, what are your views on this, and how do you think is this relevant, or what is deemed consent according to you, or from what you have gathered so far?
So deemed consent that has been introduced in this our privacy bill, which talks about an accepted consent taken from me as an individual. Now, why should I be taken? Now, for example, there is a court order across the against me. Then I should not give my consent to whether to process my personal data. The consent needs to not be taken. So this is where a deemed consent has came into picture in this privacy laws of India, where it's a voluntary consent. It's like it's they are not asking me to whether you I am giving my consent or not. Now, why this is that you will be used? Probably I have given one example for the court order. For one of the reason would be medical treatment or health care services. For example, if there is a corona kind of a situation or pandemic kind of situation, then the government will not come to you to ask whether where you are staying, can I get your consent to get you medicine? Can I get your consent to give you medical facility part of it? So that's where the deemed consent will come into picture. Now, other things like disaster. For example, if there is a cyclone or earthquake in any of the area in India, now to process or give help to the individuals or the citizens, the government will not go ahead and ask that give your consent to get you medical facility, to get your consent to a rescue would, something kind of that will come into picture. That's where the deemed consent is talking about. Now, one of the important thing probably most of our participant would like to know that the sixth point, purpose related to the employment. So for example, you are applying for a job. Now for doing that, you are giving a deemed consent to make sure that your background verification has been done. So do you have any court or legal issues with you, or any kind of fraud that you are putting across in the companies or while getting a job? So all that will be taken care of under deemed consent. And this all would be done in the public interest. So example that I could have explained you with the deemed consent and what exactly the deemed consent would be part of TPDP. I hope you were able to understand it.
Right. So I think having said that, the sixth point, right, for the purposes related to employment is something that could also be constituted as subjective, because what kind of information you're collecting from your employees and also maybe using it for employee engagement platforms, in that case you may, you know, put it as a deemed consent that your employee actually gave you consent related to employment. But employee engagement platforms and how it actually pans out in the future is one of the key areas that I would be personally interested in, because the sixth point is something that can be used or misused by organizations these days, right? Specifically because we need more clarification on what exactly deemed consent would look like for organizations in India, right? So looking at the EU perspective now, I'll just take this up as well, right? The Payment Services Directive is one of the regulations in Europe. It make sure that payments are more secure, helps banking service adapt to new technologies as well, including, you know, emerging technologies that can help banking sector, such as blockchain or, you know, any kind of AI or ML models that can help certain credit risk models or credit decisioning models. Now, PSD2 gave consumers the right to access their bank account using third parties called account information service providers or AISPs, right? So these directives that are in the EU are mostly taken as a benchmark for other countries as well, because if you look at the data privacy laws, it has been around in EU since the 1980s, right? That is when the first modern interpretation of data privacy came into picture. And from that perspective, there are newer requirements around Payment Services Directive too, right? So looking at what kind of, you know, verification can be done to handle personal data properly, ISO 27701, the PIM standard, APEC cross-border privacy rules and BCRs, right, are one of the key aspects on how to make sure that any kind of data transfers are something that is aligned to the requirements of GDPR, and how to also make sure that whenever there is a cross-border data transfer happening, it aligns with the requirements of GDPR. So ideally, SECs, DIAs, BCRs are three of those activities that organizations usually follow. But then again, some of the other ones that people can use are ISO 27701. It's not a regulation as such, but a framework that can help you create your processes, right? Then obtaining independent or external certifications. As of now, I believe there's Euro privacy certification that is there that helps you prove that you are compliant to GDPR. Any other certification that is directly claiming that you are a GDPR certified body may not hold relevant in the eyes of a supervisory authority too, right? So these are some perspectives that you have to understand from the EU region as well. And Tanin, if you could also speak a bit about the current standard and the centralized consent, because this is also something we see on most websites these days around the consent preferences center, right? So what is your opinion on the current standard within EU?
So what I understand that the banks, specifically talking about banks works in a very highly competitive environment, which I mean that if today the bank is not giving proper services, the customer will go. And to grab the customer, the representative has to work hard and to get the opportunity out of it. Now, this brings in strict regulatory frameworks across the globe. The bank has to comply with the GDPR. So marketing, and talking about more about it, marketing is one of the tool the bank is used to make sure that they get more customers out of it. Now, to do that, they need to have some kind of consent management put into picture. Now, we clearly understand, we would agree to the fact that time is money. And to save time, we got to act quickly. We got to act as in the banks or the representative of the banks need to act very quickly to get the customer from it. So to have some kind of consent management in between, who can process, who can help us to take care of this kind of consent from the data subject and making sure that we are able to provide best services to the customer, we got to make sure that we have some kind of a management platform out of it. Now, that needs to be centralized one. So we can have either by centralized consent or we can have a preference management consent platform. And this comes as a rescue for us, for example, to the fact that this two types, centralized consent and preference management platform that we are taking care of. Now, this the two ways are kind of a standard way of in EU side, they are taking care of the consent out of it. And now, what exactly it does, it provides automated control over marketing activities, the marketing activities run by the banks, and act as a transparent communication between the customers and the banks. So when we have a consent from the customer, then we can give facilities to the customer. So that can be processed by the bank. Hope I was able to make this.
Right. So the current standard, you know, is a culmination of centralized consent and a management platform. And it also helps you understand the kind of personal data you are collecting and if you're storing consent, following the consent management lifecycle too. Right. So this is the current standard. And I think there would be probably changes in it as per newer technologies or tools that come up. Now, looking at one of our last questions around Menti 2, right? So Mukul has put up the link again in the chat section. Thank you for that. So where third-party products are offered that are not related to the offer of banking product, then consent is required or consent is not required? What is your opinion? Okay, in interest of time, I'll just leave it to you, Tanin. What is your opinion on this? Do you believe consent should be collected for third-party products that are offered, which are not related to the offer of banking products?
Similarly, Krishna, it depends. If in India, right now, no. But if it's outside India, yes. Any third-party products or anything, any individual's data has been processed, we need to take a consent out of it. Now, there are a lot of things that come into picture. Now, giving in third party, if there's a bank in India and giving it the consent management to work to a third party, then need to be one more agreement that people might come into, might think about, the data processing agreement, the agreement process my data by the third party, that also will come into picture. So, as a bank, I'm giving the third party, there's an agreement with me, with the third party, that this has been done. And then the third party would take the consent, will be the consent management platform between the data subject and data processor. So yes, to answer your question, yes, we would need, even if it's a third party, we need to have a consent to do that.
Rightly said, Tanin. I completely agree with that as well. Now, I think this also brings us to the last part of today's webinar around the impact of consent management in the banking sector. So, Tanin, I would just take it up and cover over the relevant points here. So, we have discussed that a consent management platform will definitely help and obtain managed consents. Because if you're working in a complicated environment where you are relying on your website or any other tool or platform to collect a different set of personal data from different jurisdictions, then this management platform or software will definitely help and manage the entire process around it, right? Also, obtaining explicit consent helps develop that trust in your brand, helps follow one of the data processing principles around transparency, right? So it will definitely increase your customer trust and loyalty around it. Now, looking at consent management platform, when you can demonstrate compliance to certain requirements, it can also help you minimize. It can also help you minimize fines that are associated in case of a data breach, right? So any kind of penalties that would be applicable on you if you are following the process and still a data breach happened, the amount of the implication of that or the impact of that would greatly reduce, because as an organization, you put in your best foot, you put in your best effort to follow what is mandated by the law, right? Now, the last one is that it will also help you comply with multiple different data privacy laws in different jurisdictions. This part is also important in the sense that there are certain language requirements that you have to fulfill. Now, for example, if you are providing a cookie notice in a country where a different language than English is spoken, right? If maybe German is a primary language in that company, in that country, then you would want to also showcase that cookie notice or any kind of consent notice in that language as well, right? So your consent management platform would also help you to do that.
And adding to it, Krishna, probably in DPDP also, it has mentioned that we got to follow all the constitution languages that has been approved by the government, and every document needs to be should be part of those, should be converted or should have those kind of different languages, so that it's easy for the data subject to understand. So whether that individual is understanding English or any other language.
Yeah, that's right, Tanin. I think directing or correlating it to the Indian Act, the draft act, right, is relevant, because it's something that would probably be up in the future. So it also makes sense to have that capability, and your consent management tool helps you there. Now, these are some points we have discussed so far around how to make sure that you can also comply to other requirements from a law's perspective. There's one particular section that I just wanted to discuss as well, right? Depending on a user's consent choice, you can manage DSR and fire tags that are used in ad networks too. Right. So it would definitely help you with your DSR requests on how to identify it and how to also make sure that you can align it with that. Right. So consent management platform is definitely useful, but you will have to evaluate whether as an organization, it is a purchase you have to make or it is something that you can develop in-house, then, you know, that is also something that is recommended. But if not, manual process may also be something that you would use. Now, this also brings us to the end of our webinar. And we have discussed so far around consent management lifecycle. Just want to thank all of you for being patient and for being with us for the last 1 hour. Tanin, a special thanks to you too for giving in your inputs. And I think your thoughts and your insights were really, really helpful for all our participants.